Thank you. Hello, everyone. So, welcome. So today we are going to discuss different things from the programming craft. About the status quo, about where it's going. And I'm going to be moderating this discussion with with people from different corners of game development. So please welcome Tomasz Szałkowski from Techland. Jakub Duda from Incuvo. Andrea Magnorski from Bad Cat Games. Yuri Rauwe from Guerrilla Games. And Łukasz Wołowiec from CD Projekt Red. So I'm just going to ask each participant to say a few words about themselves, their work, and what do they use on a daily basis in the life of a programmer.
So hi everyone, I'm Tom Szałkowski, I'm senior engine programmer at Techland. I'm mostly involved in rendering processes on next gen consoles, so PS4 and Xbox One, and DirectX 11 on the PC. On my everyday work, I'm using Visual Studio, LLVM, code chain, and half of my work is done in this assembly window. So I'm profiling, I'm debugging. So I don't know if I fit here because I don't care about the code. I care more about the data, because the programming, the language is a tool for the programming for me. I care about the processes, how the data is transferred from one place to another, and how to accomplish this process in fast way. But we'll see. Maybe I will put something, some light from my point of view in this discussion.
Don't be so hard on yourself.
So, hi, I'm Jacob. Well, as Incuvo is just slightly smaller than Techland or CD Projekt, I'm wearing several hats in the company. I'm managing it, but I'm also trying to be a programmer. This is my, let's say, long-time job and learned job. Whatever is the life after C++, I'm already there, and that's why probably they asked me to come here, because we're currently doing our projects in Unity, so that's C#, that's a completely different world, so I'm the zombie here. What I'm doing, I'm in programming work. I'm mostly dealing with optimization stuff and prototyping new features.
Hello, my name is Andrea Magnorski, and I also don't know why am I here. It seems to be a common topic from Lessex, choosing panelists. I don't know. Are you sure? So what I do is I'm one of the two developers in our company. We're building a game called Onikira Demon Killer, which you all bought in Steam, right? Yes, 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 collaboration from people, yes. I won't continue until you all say yes. Good, good. Anyway, what I do every day is write C# and F# sometimes. And at the moment, I'm actually working on the port of our engine, which is an open source C# engine called Duality, written by a German dude, and if you like open source engines, you should check it out. I think that's it. I probably didn't answer the question, but whatever.
Okay, hello, my name is Joris Rauwe. I'm a lead game tech at Guerrilla Games. Worked on Killzone Shadowfall mainly last couple of years. And we heavily use C++. We had a short love affair with C#, but we've now almost completely ditched it again and are fully back in the C++ corner. So I don't know why we're in the live after C++ panel, because we're fully in.
He's sending you a message.
Yeah, and I'm not quite in his camp. I'm a more of a high level coder, so I don't like looking at the disassembly too much. I think it makes sense for rendering, but the things that I work on, like more gameplay systems, I think you should stick to object oriented, etc. And performance is not really the biggest thing in my department.
Okay, hi all, I'm Łukasz Wołowiec. I'm working as a senior tool programmer in CD Projekt Red. Last 2 years working on like a little game called Witcher 3. And I'm here probably to be... Sorry? Yeah, so like Flash game, yeah. So I'm here probably to be an advocate from C++ also, I guess. So we will see. So I'm also in favor rather of like higher level programming, so we will see how it will come.
And just a few words to reconcile those different point of views. That was like the whole idea, to get different views on C++ and programming in general. So I was wondering, considering the... Okay, so just for the sake of formality, my name is Leszek Godlewski. I'm an engine programmer at the Astronauts. And I mostly do custom rendering stuff currently in Unreal Engine 4. Yeah. Coming back to what I was getting to. considering the status quo of the programming environment that you have, are you happy with it? And do you see it, the way that you program and the way that you work, do you see it surviving for the immediate future for, I don't know, let's say 5 years, without any significant changes in how things work in general, meaning like the daily routine of things that you do, how you write your code, how you debug it, how you process it in other ways? So anyone willing to pick it up? If not, then we just go around.
So, particularly, I'm happy with C++ because our code base is almost 15 years old. There are some really scary places where there are monsters. Yeah. Chrome Engine, this is the name of our in-house engine that is powering, for example, Dying Light, is very, very old. Some parts are remembering the times when the engine was some kind of extension of Java language. So you could find some information about RTTI, just that Java is messing here around, and you could see it actually in C++. But right to the point, in the last few years, we were transformed all our engine and most of game engine code. I will explain what is it. We've got a few layers in our code. The base is the engine. On top of it, there is a game engine, the most common parts of the engine. So there live the AI, for example, the navigation mesh, some sound systems. And on top of it, there is a game. The game that is shaping the tools, that's got unique subset of editor windows, for example, specific code, etc. So, using C++, we were able to move from 32 bits to 64 bits. That was our first step for the next generation consoles. So, if this could happen, and we moved many, many parts from single serial threaded processing to multi-threaded that scales actually up to, I don't know, even 1,000 cores, if there is enough data to process, of course. For me, the C++, which I can profile, I can check what's doing on the CPU is doing, how it's doing, what's the cooperation with the GPU on the next generation consoles, where is the data, who is processing it, who can read, who can write, for example. This is good choice for me right now. So C++, I'm happy with C++.
Okay, so let me start with some history. When my first game I wrote was for Game Boy Advance, I wrote it in C++, and at that time I severely violated Nintendo guidelines because they disadvised this language as being too high level. So now it's a kind of a power horse for low level stuff, and I believe that Tomek and all of you guys are perfectly safe with the job. It's for the engine stuff. It's perfect. Well, maybe not perfect, but it's very well for the job, and it will stay this for a long, long time. But nowadays, I believe that this is all evolving to an abstraction layers like .NET, Mono, what Unity tries to do, that we have a cross-platform engine that's abstracted from hardware. We are in an indie era, and not all developers can afford to have all these custom engines, and not all developers are willing to invest into having top-notch art, top-notch high-end games. And for a lot of purposes, Unity is perfect. And don't get me wrong, they are doing amazing job. Progress in the last few years, it's unbelievable. And that said, with my current set, I could make a long, long list of what needs to be improved, what could be improved in the tool chain. But again, it's going to be an evolution unless we have some kind of totally new paradigm of programming appearing. I don't see it disappearing anywhere soon. I just think it will get stronger.
Okay, so the question was about the tools we use and are we happy with them? So my tools are, at the moment, what I use is C# and F#. F#, for those of you who don't know, is a functional first language developed by Microsoft but currently maintained by the open source community. And then the F# open source organization foundation. So anyway, that's a sidetrack. But am I happy with it? Yes, I'm pretty happy. I think there is some extra work that could be done on the tooling side of things from a developer experience point of view. But I think the main thing about tooling is that it needs to work for you. Does what works for me definitely won't work for him. Might work for him. I don't know if it works for them, but it's a very personal, we'll need to hear the stories, otherwise it's not funny. But the main thing is context is king. And then you have to make sure you find the environment and the tools that help you do what you have to do, which is always different to what everybody else is doing.
Okay, so being firmly in the C++ camp, I think we'll stay there for a long while. At our studio, I do see the trend that we're moving towards more high-level languages, but mainly for gameplay-related things. So we've implemented our own visual programming language, for example. But like low-level rendering, physics, all those sorts of systems, I don't see C++ going away very quickly in that. I do think there's a lot of things that can be improved about C++, and it's definitely not moving as fast as it should be, especially in turnaround times, and that is what we are kind of trying to solve by introducing all these higher-level concepts so that you don't actually have to recompile the whole game before you can see your changes. So I think that's, that's our main. Is my main vision for the future.
Okay, so our whole like toolset and engine is written in C++. So it's C++. I'm working with like all the time, and I'm quite happy with it. But the funny thing is, we are just planning to do quite the opposite you just did. So we are thinking about switching to C# for our tool side, mostly because of iteration times, basically. Because this is, I think, one of major problems with C++ now, like all those compilation times and stuff. So we will see what will happen, but we are strongly considering like switching to C#. So it makes our discussion really like interesting. Okay, so we'll see.
Can I answer that?
Yeah.
Okay, so why did we move from C# back to C++? Well, so we had an editor framework in C#. We had, I think at some point, we had about 3 people working on it. A couple of people left, and in the end, we had 1 person working on it. and it's just stayed at that one person. And we have, I don't know, we have like 60 programmers or so in the company, and there was only one person who could do editor work. And it was very complicated. Maybe our framework was not good, it's possible, but people didn't know that code, so it kind of died. And then we decided to just rewrite the whole thing from scratch in C++, and all of a sudden, all the programmers jumped in, and everybody started making new tool windows, and it just went a lot quicker than this one guy who was programming alone. So I'm quite happy that we did it this way, and maybe everyone in your company can program C Sharp, but if that's not the case, then you may want to reconsider.
Can I ask why did you decide to go to C Sharp, and was that a team decision? And then, you know, it seems like the non-adoption of C Sharp also was not like intentional, it just kind of happened. So is this more of a management problem than a language problem? Maybe it went from. I'm just asking.
So like, it was a very conscious decision at the time to go to C Sharp, because everybody thought that UI programming would be the majority of time spent in making tools, and that would actually save a lot of time in C Sharp. But it turned out that you have to write everything kind of twice. If you if you have your engine in C++ and the rest in C Sharp, you have to duplicate a lot of code. They have to keep you have to keep them in sync. And what we can now just do, we can just use the classes as they are in the engine. They work as they are in the engine. You can just call normal functions on them to make modifications on them. You don't have to write everything twice anymore. And that makes it, it makes it more crash prone, that's for sure. But it's it makes it a lot faster to develop with. I was against the whole move to C++ when we started it. I was like, okay, we're going to waste like half a year of time doing this new editor, and in the meantime, we're not going to have anything. But since all the programmers picked it up, it went actually quite smooth, and I'm quite happy with the move now.
nothing scary. Yeah, nothing scary. No. It's fine. The thing we are trying to do is quite an opposite. As I said, it's even to the point we want to separate like the creation of tools from like other teams. So it's the opposite you just achieved. Like the everyone can hop into this and just write tools. That maybe thing to consider is like we are trying to release the tools to general public. That's the thing. So we want them to really be like. Yeah, we did that like two times already. We will be doing this again. But the thing is, those tools are not perfect from the UI's point of view. Basically, because like all programmers are able to add functionality to this, which is not really good if you want to show something to the general public. Basically, you want the UI to be consistent and fluent and, you know, really well done. Which is probably we are going from just another like side to this problem.
And is C Sharp going to fix that for you? Because I think the making the user interface, if you're not a user interface designer, then it doesn't matter if you do that in C Sharp or in C++, you're going to end up with a bad interface in both cases.
Yeah, but it's like it's a bigger picture. We are not only switching to C Sharp just because of it. It's like we are considering different things. And UI designing tools are much better on C Sharp's side, that's for sure. Yeah. 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 Like the thing is, I came from another company. It was not a game dev company, and we just did it. Like it worked up. Yeah. Yeah. We are like going into details right now. I don't know if it's just the right time to. Yeah, because we can discuss like this inter-process communication stuff and so on, but it's not like I think related to the discussion. But we are aware of all those problems, and we know that it's not that simple. It's not like we switch a language and done. It's okay right now. So we are aware, but.
I know, but I was just thinking, no, not to prepare the answer.
Yeah. Yeah, so that would be my answer to this.
Okay, so maybe steering back onto the subject. There is this thing that some computer scientists have prophesied that concurrency is going to be increasingly important, and that there was a presentation by Tim Sweeney of Epic Games in, I think, 2009 or something like that, where he expected consumer machines to get dozens of CPU cores in the coming 2 or 3 years. And it's 2015 now, and we know that this doesn't happen. And I know that GPUs can have hundreds or even thousands of cores at the moment, but the CPUs in consumer machines still get about, I don't know, 8 cores on the high end, right? So will that shift to like this from multi-core to many-core, where you get dozens, or even mega-core, where you get hundreds, thousands, millions of cores on the CPU? Do you think this is going to happen anytime soon, or is it going to happen at all?
This microphone is the perfect analogy of what's happening in games right now. So there's how many? 2, 4, 6 of us, and we're using the voice thread to render voice to all of you. I mean, okay, it's like, right? I mean, we all know all your phones in your pockets have at least 2 cores, if you're poor, or if you're slightly richer, 4 or maybe 8. And I did that as a joke, okay, no offense. So it is there already. If we choose to pay attention to it or not is our decision. A lot of people are already doing interesting things with multiple cores in games, and I'm thinking of Alex Champandar doing some crazy AI on the GPU. So it's coming, it's there, and I think if you're interested, it's super cool. Also, you can do it low level, you can do it high level, you can do it whatever you want, but it's there. So you can just do this. No. Anybody?
Maybe.
I think that it's coming for a CPU in x86 architecture. Yes, it's coming, but I think it's already here because the way we could program CPU and GPU interaction right now, for the consoles, you have shared memory, so the GPU may be executing kernels using compute shaders, prepare the data, and the CPU may read it back without any latency. The startup, the execution of the dispatch call is something like ring bell. So when I'm writing to the register that is pointing to the beginning of the compute shader, it's executing immediately without any delay, without anything. It's of course it may be stored in some kind of command buffer to store the commands, but there are some rings that are processes that are processed independently of the current command buffer's execution. So you might just go to the GPU and say, hello, execute this as fast as possible for me, and you are using a lot of processing power. So for me, when I'm using the PS4 or Xbox One, it's the same thing. There is multi-core already. You must think about the problem, how to split it in n number of entities, how to process the data without the dependency. If you can solve the dependency problem, you are able to scale up to millions of cores. It's it's a matter of the design. If your design is good, you are able to utilize all the resources that are available on the hardware. It's no matter if you run some part of your program on the CPU or the GPU. If you have data in and data out, it's only the matter of the transformation. It's not dependent on the underlying hardware. So, for example, updating AI in the game, you need to shoot rays on the scene and catch the collisions, the intersections between geometry and the rays. it's a perfect fit right now for the GPU to process the data. You have all the rays, you have the scene in the triangle stuff or something else, and you are just testing and giving the results. The results are ready for the CPU to use. It's the way that on the PC, there will be some ways to work in the same manner as on the next generation console right now. So it's the future that is done already. It's not x86 everywhere, but sometimes it's x86 plus GPU processing, but you must to think about how to code in unlimited resources that you could use to solve your problem.
Not much to say here from the high level, so just move along. But I wanted to ask you one thing. Don't you think that this architecture, CPU versus GPU, could be more unified in terms how you work with it? Because now it seems that you need to kind of connect two very different worlds to put it to your use.
As I mentioned, if the CPU and the GPU uses the same memory, so the memory is shared, and when you are able to execute GPU kernels just after writing to the register, so it's immediately. You are just configuring the priorities for your work, so you have pipes that you could say that, okay, now you are rendering my scene, this asynchronous thing, and I need response right now. So the cooperation is already very good on the consoles.
Yeah, that's what I wanted to ask. Do you find this solution to multi-core comfortable, or would you take
Yes, it's very comfortable, and currently I'm exploring this area, and I'm trying to push to the limit to check out where's the limit, what could be done better on the GPU than on the CPU. Right now, we could even process whole scene on the GPU and generate data for the GPU itself in the one shot. It's something that's unique right now. We've never been able to do something because you are transferring every data to the GPU. GPU is processing it, generates data for it, and renders from it. And the CPU is laying back and, okay, hey, you're done. Okay, I will check 100 frames per second. Great job. I've done nothing.
Yeah, so do you still need the CPU architecture? Maybe you just should have.
Yes, because there is a lot of things that needs to be. For example, network synchronization, DMA transfers for the audio data.
Okay. We need to draw a line.
Okay.
Too much detail. Yeah. So. Yeah, but you know, it's kind of like my own two cents to this is that you were talking about all these different things, and you know, this is what I also wanted to ask when I asked about your opinion about the environment that you have, because working with compute shaders and C++ code, you know, you have the different languages, you have the different compilers. It's not a unified architecture in you know, even in the toolchain. There are different quirks for C++. There are different quirks for the shading languages, you know. And then putting this all together is a little bit tricky.
I think that the language, the programming language, is only the tool to make the job done. So it's not about the language problem. It's not the code problem. It's the problem about how to make a good design and how to spread the data across the memory so that your design allows you to run, to solve your problem on the CPU or the GPU, for example. It doesn't matter what is the language. When we are processing data on the CPU in the way that you are not blocking on the dependencies, the code is mostly very simple. It's some kind of functional programming. Then when you call a function, you need a context. And when the state is, everything is mutable, there's no dependencies there. So this kind of programming allows you to move to the GPU very, very easily.
Okay, modular the language differences. Do you guys want to add something in on the subject of multicore?
Yeah, so I think multi-core right now for us works pretty well. We don't put a lot on the GPU in terms of general logic, simply because artists always want to push more polygons and they win in the end. So they basically get the GPU for their polygons and we get the CPU to do everything else. But I do wonder if the current architecture is going to work in the future. I mean, the more cores we're going to get, then at a certain point, memory is going to be such a big bottleneck, even bigger than it already is. So I wouldn't be surprised if at some point we go back to a PlayStation 3-like architecture where actually every core has its own set of memory and we need to really think about the data transformation and make sure that all the data is local so that it can run at a maximum speed. At the same time, I mean, we had that on PlayStation 3, and it was a lot of work to get anything done there, to split all the data. And I think it works really well if you're in, like, rendering area, physics area, really low-level systems, then it works fine. But as soon as you get to game code, then it's really, really difficult to think about it that way. And especially if you want to quickly iterate over your game, then you definitely need some kind of higher-level concept. And for us, that then usually turned out to be the bottleneck because, yeah, it was spaghetti code. It didn't run.
Well, what if it, in that architecture, the language managed the memory and the splitting of data for you? But do you think that will cope with the high speed of iteration you need and the problems of the kind of basic hardware architecture that you have? And I'm thinking kind of how Clojure does that, it does the concurrency for you behind your back. It's like, oh no, I'm going to run in all your cores, blah. So if we can do the same with this different architecture, then maybe we can get the best of both worlds.
Yeah, personally, I can see that work in certain areas, but especially in game code, I cannot see that work because the interdependencies between all the different game objects are just simply too big to account for in that way. And you can make everything else very optimized, but that is still going to be an issue. And I don't really see how the language is going to solve that for me.
Yeah, nothing to add really. Like the gameplay code, it's usually like the web of interdependencies, so it's really hard to parallelize it like automatically. So yeah. Okay, maybe. Okay.
Oh no, the only way to properly kind of go and say, okay, this can be done, is actually going forwards and doing it. I think you can totally manage that with the language. It wouldn't be very performant, but if you're trying to get
But that's the point.
but then wait. The thing like there's a but there. Thing there is that maybe you get the extra performance you need because you have so many cores. So you kind of pay for it with the price of the hardware, which you already have loads of.
Yeah, that makes sense. Wait, let me just. We are currently at a moment where pretty much every major game engine has a subsystem for a task or job graph. And I was just wondering if getting to the granularity from a single thread to then having on different subsystems on different threads to finally having just a bunch of small tasks which are then taken from a queue. And are we already at the end of the roadmap, or is it going to complicate even further with some further fine granulation of tasks? What do you think?
Shortly this time. I'll try. We have such class, it's Job Manager inside our engine, and it's working very fine. The fine graining is at the level of the tasks that you are spawning, so it's up to you what you are sent to the Job Manager. It's very good and it's working. There are some issues that needs to be solved. Right now we are thinking about moving the back of task to execute to every thread independently, so there will be no global storage for it, and every touch, every worker thread will get his own queue for the tasks. We are thinking about more than six cores right now, so that's why we are concerned about it. But it's working right now, and it's okay.
But what about the future?
Okay, about the future. So, like, good segue, because I'm doing on the side just to play with things, my like little engine, and I've written a job system using futures. And futures are the so that's the perfect segue. A future is an object which you are for example, you've got a job system, you are invoking you are passing a function to be executed on like separate thread, and the function returns you a future, which is something which is a value, which is an object, which contains a future value of the result of the function. That's the idea. So until you read the value, the program is not blocked. So you can store it like a side and continue with your evaluations. And once the value is needed, the flow is blocked here and waits until the value is ready from the separate thread. And I think it's a good area for experiments right now, and I will see if it will work for me. Right now, it's just experiments, as I said.
Is it fundamentally different than a job graph?
It's in the same realm, just a neat abstraction, I would say.
That is needed locally and right now. So, may you elaborate more about the future concept?
Okay, as I said, I just started to play with it. It's just, so for me, just an the neat idea. I will try to implement. I just implemented this job system using it, but I haven't used it for something concrete, really. That's what why I said it's just only an experiment right now. But I saw it's used in various places, and I was just told by some people that it's really, really good way of solving those things. So we'll see. Another thing, to maybe just to end up this future thing, I saw a really nice presentation about cooperative multi-threading, like to aside from job system, you can use just also cooperative multi-threading, just yields and stuff to help to it will help you to saturate usage of all cores, because you know.
I comment on that, okay. Because we tried them out, fibers, they are called, and we actually shipped Killzone 3 using fibers for game code, and we tried to hide all the latencies to the SPUs doing that, and we ditched it because it didn't really work out. The fibers, it's really hard to find deadlock situations because it's so completely free. And a dependency graph is 10 times clearer. You cannot do it wrong because you can, when you construct a dependency graph, you can validate that there is no cyclic dependencies. And with fibers, it's so easy to say, okay, I'm going to wait for this result, and then another fiber is going to wait for me, and there's no way to verify that is actually working properly.
Have you done a presentation on that? Maybe it was even yours. So. Okay, so I was misled by your presentation then. Okay.
Yeah, that's actually a GDC presentation that I did last year. And by accident, I did a talk today, and by accident, they put the description from last year on the web page. So he hoped to see that presentation today, but sorry. Not with the fibers, but like last year's presentation was about how we then ditched fibers and implemented a job graph system for our entity updating logic, and we still do that. I think that works really nicely. I think So we haven't jobified everything in our engine yet, but in my ideal world, the main function would just be execute this graph. And then obviously we can modify the graph on the fly to adjust it to match the particular situation. But I don't think there should be a main thread that does most of the orchestration anymore. It should just be a job graph. And we're slowly moving in that direction, but it's really hard to get there because there's just so many spaghetti code when you get to things like the main game loop, then it's all spaghetti.
Okay, so you also mentioned in your presentation, yeah, I was there, so I remember that you have some elements of message passing in Killzone Shadowfall as well. And I also went to a talk at CodeMesh in London of a Paul Butcher who basically argued that threads and locks and managing them manually are, you know, like not adequate anymore in today's computing because they are too difficult and too error prone. And he basically proposed this to replace manual threads and locks management with some more high level concepts like message passing. But you know, I am under the impression that the overhead from managing such a high level system like message passing is just simply too great. So, any opinions on that?
Okay, I'll take this one. So, I think for low-level stuff, thread managing and doing that stuff makes sense, at least right now. I think at higher levels, the overheads are not significant. Obviously, it depends on the size of your project. I don't have The Witcher to play with. I mean, I can play it, but but I don't have that code with the problems of that size of a project. But I would argue that they are not as big, particularly if you manage it at the right level. Say you have messaging systems for particular, like, okay, I'm just gonna send my gameplay, messages, or say AI just shares some, a blackboard here for data. So it's a question of context, as always. That's so far what we experienced.
So I just wanted to add that you touched a very important topic. It's all about low level versus high level. And when we're thinking about making games, we're on the high level, we probably wouldn't want to invest into doing all this. We would expect guys like you to provide us with the best possible tools that would do it for us. So we would concentrate on the actual game development. And for us, as the hardware gets more and more powerful, maybe the price of the overhead is worth paying if it ends up for us being simpler and cheaper to develop.
Okay, going back to the locks quickly, because I think locks are not dead. I think they're dead in complex code, but I think if there's a clear ownership of some system, and if you have like one physics world or something, and you need to lock a particular aspect of it, then it's completely fine to use locks because it's very clear that only one system owns it, and at very particular points. And then as you start calling that function more and more often, then all of a sudden it doesn't work anymore, so you have to come up with something else. But for things that you don't touch a lot, I think it's a very easy way to go. If you go high volume, then you definitely need something else, and then it becomes a mess, especially if you have many dependencies between different tasks. You really need a job graph rather than locks. And then I completely agree that locks are dead, and fibers for the same reason. As for high level, I also completely agree that all of these things really make sense for the really low level things. As soon as you get to game code, you want to be able to write spaghetti code. You need to be able to write something that you can throw away, and you don't need to think about performance. So
I'm going to challenge the only thing I'm going to challenge out of all of that is that you don't have to write spaghetti code. You can write really nice non-spaghetti code in games. You don't have to either, you know, but you can, but you shouldn't.
And the next day, there will be a game designer next to your desk, and he says, well, I wanted to do kind of the opposite of what I wanted it to do yesterday, and then the model breaks down.
I would add only one thing. You can write spaghetti here and there, but never copy and paste. Thank you.
This is when we get the lightsabers out, right?
I just wanted to comment the spaghetti code. Eric Rice, the guy behind the Lean Startup Ideas, said that by the end of the day, if users don't like your game, your product, whatever, the best code you wrote ever and the crappiest code you wrote ever will be thrown away in the same matter. So if you get to the point when you can show great game to your users, I don't mind spaghetti code. If you want to make a sequel based on the same code, then maybe you can think twice.
As I said, we have a code that is almost 15 years old, so there is a lot of spaghetti there. And I think that the code is not the point. If the code is performing well, if it's fast, if you are able to modify it, and you are able to read it for so it's okay. It doesn't mean it's yes. It's a talk about blonde women are better than black women. Yeah. Right now we like some patterns that are in code. We are sometimes talking that this code looks clean, this is ugly, but this and that code, if it's working and it's okay, it's okay. Yeah, it's no need to change it to make it more pretty. If it's working for us, it's okay. So I want to back to the message and the logs. I know the presentation you mentioned. So the message. Problem is something like if you have a serial thing, then that you could break down to phases. So for example, update of a logic entity in the game, you are breaking the problem into phases. For example, first you are gathering the information about the environment where something that entity is. You are making the decisions and you are modifying animations for it, for example. And when you split this one serial update into three phases and run it concurrently or in parallel, one of the possibilities to move the data from one phase to another is to produce messages that are in the form of command buffers. So there are some things. So the product of the phase, one phase, that is shipped to the another is a small memory block that is telling us this object changes state from this one to this. This happens here and modifies this. So the next phase will read back this data and processes with its normal code path. Yeah. So this all about the message is, it's a matter of implementation. I think you could implement message system in a way that it's executing a lot of callbacks and it spikes on the CPU every time a player, for example, a web browser where you enter one key, there are sometimes half or maybe 1 second lag. It depends what was the path of the message. And the short message that is connecting phases for a process is good. I forget, sorry.
Okay, so if you have questions, you should ask us. Because just in case you might be like, oh, I'm dying to ask you a question, and also maybe not fall asleep. So ask questions as they're coming in to your brains. So we're.
Okay, so talking about hopping subjects. Yeah, so let's maybe just go back to the title of this panel for a moment and C++. Yes. you know, I've once was linked to a question on Stack Exchange. I can't remember which one exactly. Probably the game dev Stack Exchange. And there was a novice programmer asking about which languages should he learn. And basically the overwhelming response was C++. And now, why is, you know, maybe...
Ask them what they know first. Yeah. So what language...
Do you guys... Okay, so who knows C++? Raise your hand. Okay, and...
Another language.
Oh, okay, maybe C sharp?
Oh, same number.
Yeah, similar number. Okay, anything functional? yeah, there are a couple hands. Yeah, great. Yeah, so... Oh, okay, and assembly? Assembly language of any CPU at all? Okay, that's still considerably more than functional. Well, anyway... So, you know, it seems that C++ has a definite foothold in the industry, and it seems to be dominant, but is it really? And, I mean, with the democratization of game development through Unity and other, you know, ready-made game engines, is really C++ still dominant? And if it is it does it deserve the domination, the dominant position that it has?
So first I wanted to correct you, Unity is no longer high-level engine. There's this company Ketchup, maybe any one of you heard of it, and they are using an engine Buildbox, which makes Unity a totally low-level stuff. So we are slowly, as we can build ideas without using the full performance of our 8-core mobile phones or whatever, we may no longer opt for the low-level stuff. And I think I said at the beginning, I think that learning C++ is for a long, long time a very safe investment, and I don't see it going away. I would like to see it being stripped of some of the past burden of all the deprecated stuff. It, you know, C++ is C with objects, so now maybe to satisfy you, it should be C++ with functions. Some stuff that would, for functional, yeah. I'm simplifying things. Some stuff that would try to enforce correct functional programming stuff like this. And I was quite happy to see that Tostrup guy actually woke up after 8 years of not modifying the language and started the committee again in sometime 2010. So. I don't see it going away. It will be less important as Tomek is a bit of a dinosaur here with assembly.
No, wait.
Let me finish. You know, there are a lot of people that are still saying that C++ is too high level and they will only write in C. And now you will find quite a lot of people that will tell you that C++ is a low level engine and C sharp is good enough.
Yeah. No, I will not advise assembly for the to the novice programmer because I will advise BASIC. I love playing around with BASIC. On the PC, there is pure BASIC that I really love, and actually, I'm learning my 11-year-old son how to program in pure BASIC. Why? Because everything is there. If you need to draw something using sprites, it's there. If you need to play sound, it's there. You need to open the screen and make some graphics, it's there. You want to print out some text and make an adventure game that's you are in the cave. You can turn left, A, turn right, B. What are you doing? Input, A, enter. Next text. It's very simple. The learning the programming is not about learning the semantics of the language. C++ is not an easy language to learn. BASIC is very straightforward, and languages like, for example, Scratch, the graphical ones, they could learn you the thinking of the machine. You need to think how to break the problem into the processes the CPU may process. The computer is executing the code. You must think how to design the code to succeed in solving a problem. It's not about class, what was the sign? Okay, bracket, opening bracket, compilation error. No, it's not about that. Language is just a tool, and for the beginner, you need a beginner tool. And basic is fits it great for me. Basic rules.
Basic rules. Okay. Yeah. Yeah. Start learn programming. That you need probably C++ or something to grasp object programming. Then you need Haskell or something to grasp functional. But the language is a tool.
Well, okay. So in 1959 or 57, right? There was this bunch of people. Well, actually, the one student that implemented a language called Lisp. Okay, so we're talking 1959, before C, before C++. It's really old, and Lisp is a pure, or like a non-pure functional language. If I was trying to tell someone, hey, you know, maybe it's a good idea to learn Lisp, and I would say yes. And I wasn't alone, because I think MIT was using it for their first year undergraduate program for the last 30 years. I think they just recently switched to Python, because it's so widely adopted. But it's for the same reasons that you mentioned. It's a small language with very simple constructs that it's really simple. And then you can learn, and it teaches you how to think abstractly, which is actually what you need to learn. From then on, if you're going to do low-level game engine programming, learning C or C++ is totally valuable, if that's what you want to do. The thing is, like, in your first year undergraduate, you probably have no clue what you want to do. So you're probably just, like, dreaming of something rather than concretely dream. So learn basics. How does your operating system works? What is memory? What kind of memories there are? What are these different CPUs? And what do they do? Don't hurt me. So it depends on what you want to do. So start with something simple. Basic is good. Lisp is good. And it's true. C++ is super hard to learn properly. C# is actually pretty hard to learn itself, because you not only have the language, you have the framework, a virtual machine to deal with. So, you know, the hardest thing about doing C# and F# is that you wind up dealing with a bunch of C++ libraries that have some sort of integration written in the style of C++ so badly in C# that it makes me want to go find whoever wrote that, grab it with a, you know, very wet towel, do this, so that, you know, just give it to me. If you know C or C++, great. Give me your nicely wrapped thing that you know how to do properly, and I will deal with it. But you know, there's no point in wrapping this stuff in, you know, if you do C++, you don't automatically know C#. You just need to know how if and while and stuff like that works, which is cool. But, you know, I don't go there pretending, oh, yeah, I totally know this C stuff. Totally, I don't, right? So anyway, I don't know if I answered the question, but it was funny.
Okay, back to the original question about like C++ going away. I'm not seeing it going away anytime soon. That's for sure. And you ask so you are asking about if it deserves being an industry standard de facto. But I think it's not about like being industry standard. It's not about being the best. It's about being good enough and widely spread. So I think the momentum of this now, it's so huge that it won't go away, even though it has like many problems, because all those libraries that exist and stuff. So I'm not seeing it going away anytime soon. 11, it's cool. I think that we've got it on our list. So
yeah, but there's no problem.
Okay, so what do you want to ask?
Well, it's just what do you think? Like, you know, would you?
Yeah, we already moved. Like, yeah, we are using like many features from C++ 11, and at home, like for my side projects, I'm even using like some C++ 14 stuff, like lambdas futures are inside the standard right now. Many things. I just I've got hard time to just to recall it from the top of my head, but I'm using almost all features of C++ 11.
I think there's one thing really evil, and that is the auto keyword. And I think it's evil for the reason that the auto keyword, which means that you don't need to declare declare the type of your variable anymore. And the thing that I find evil about it is that it makes it really easy to copy like complete arrays by value if you didn't think about it. So if you just write auto something over a complex structure, it will actually copy the element in the structure rather than take a reference to it. And it's really easy to get bitten by that. Also, I think it makes the code unreadable.
Yes, but as with all things in C++, you have to know what you are doing. That's the thing. So I'm using auto, but not everywhere. That's the thing. If I know that it will be hard to read or something like that, I won't use it. That's the thing. Or auto reference. Yeah, you can always like say auto reference, like ampersand. And so. Okay. So.
There are things that are coming up in or have already. I'm not even sure what's the status of delivery of the features in real world compilers. But there is the C++ 14, which received some, I would say, pretty esoteric features, like the like this sort of template like thing that. I don't even remember the name for that, but it's like something that I had a really bad time finding a use for besides playing with things like adding. One of the examples that I saw was that somebody had the code which pretty much looked like add 1 foot to 1 meter to one whatever unit of distance, and it did. Probably, and yeah, so yeah. It doesn't appear to me like those are really features that we really need.
With this very thing, I agree. It's rather, I don't know, it's, you can like overload or define your prefixes, I think. So it's like if you got this string with big L at the beginning, so it means like it's Unicode string. You can define your own stuff this way, which is really like subtle and complicated. And I don't know if you really need it, yeah, to be honest. So yeah.
Anything to add? Yeah, okay. Okay. So maybe let's move on to the next subject, which would be. There was this interesting presentation, apart from Mike Acton's, which probably made the round from CppCon last year. There was another one from a programmer from Ubisoft in Canada, and in which he basically told how they use C++ in at Ubisoft. And I already know that you are a fan of one of the solutions, namely the custom implementation of virtual functions that they rolled out. But there is this symptom that basically every engine has their own core library, meaning that they have their own reflection, they have their own serialization, they have their own file input output, and so on. And it's madness, you know. The functionality overlaps a lot between all those engines, and should it really continue to be this way that everyone rolls their own such, you know, base, very basic level things?
Okay, so the answer is it depends. It's all about what you actually need. The language is very flexible, and the virtual table implementation was needed at Ubisoft because they wanted to reload the virtual objects in the runtime. So they need their custom solution for that to accomplish. Yeah, it's not a standard thing that you are reloading something in memory. They wanted to iterate really fast and to compile code without. Breaking the execution of the current one. So they are just holding back, replace the pointers in the jump table, and that's all. And they are running they are continued running the application. So yes, everything that you need and you are able to do, it's okay to do it. When you need to custom jump tables, go for it. When you need custom allocators, go for it. When you need to replace all the world because you need it, go for it. It's okay, but don't do that if you really don't need to. Everything should be suited for the situation. So if you, as I said, if you need to go for it. I'm okay with it.
I just wanted to compare it to a movie industry. It's if we look at this, it's far below like making your own cameras. It's like making your own videotapes. And I believe that as everything matures, as hardware is stronger, as games will mature, this will be needed way less often than it is now. It's like everybody trying to invent the wheel on his own. And sometime there will be probably common solutions that will be more widely adopted.
Okay, if everybody is trying to invent the wheel, that points me that most of the people doesn't need the wheel, the new wheel. Yeah, as I said, if you need to replace something or create something that is done actually, but you need it to be done in a different way because. You need to fit in the 60 milliseconds to get the 60 frames per second for the console, for example. You need to deliver really high performance routines to process something. And if the basic language implementation is stopping you from doing that, it's very okay for me to replace the faulty methods, processes that are under the C++ hood. And it's very good that the C++ supports this. It allows you to replace some core mechanics like virtual tables. Yeah, it's really great. We, for example, are storing everything in binary data. We've got a class writer object that can read virtual object from the memory, from each of the it can generate the footprint of the object as it, as for example, on the PC, we are generating data that will be loaded in one chunk on the console, and it's okay. It's something like native data created by the compiler in runtime. So we need such tools to load map in one chunk, for example. We are not loading a lot of data and creating. We are loading chunk of data in memory and just updating the pointers that, okay, this is all the created objects are here. We are just loaded them. We need that tool and we crafted that.
Just quick answer. Yeah, I totally get it. You're fighting with a very limited environment. I am just thinking that when it comes to certain border, let's say it's 4K, 60 FPS, cinema-like effects in current gen console, This kind of stuff will no longer be needed unless used by a very limited group of people, and it will get standardized far more than it is now.
I think that's not true. I think if we get that hardware, then we will just push twice as many polygons, or we will go for real-time ray tracing, or I don't know what. We'll come up with something to make use of it. And I don't think there will be a border. I mean, we're going to push it, and there's always going to be a difference between the people who really went to the metal and the people who didn't. And you will see that, and that's the difference between like the super triple A titles and the lesser titles.
That's the main difference between like game dev and other industries, I think, because I came from like another line of industry, which was just applications, like desktop applications, and then there is a line. You just won't be doing like really low level optimizations, like because it makes no sense. But I think in game dev, there will be like always will be someone who will like push like twice as much polygons, and basically then he wins. That's the thing. So, she, sorry, he or she.
No, there I have a question for you. I totally understand that you need it maybe sometimes.
I wanted to add that's why we
because you don't need it. But on that question of the when you do need it, why isn't it open source? Most of the times, sometimes, particularly in the past, those like I need my wheel to be slightly smaller or bigger or wider or whatever. You know, my wheel needs to be blah, whatever the necessity is. I need my custom BCL. And wouldn't it be great if that wheel became available? Like you just wrote your common, you know, rewrote a custom common library. Great. You need it for a reason. Document it and put it out there and see if it's actually any good. Not many companies do that. And I kind of, that's where I, because the not invented here, which is this syndrome, happens because, you know, you invented it, then he needed a slightly tiny different wheel, and he went and wrote his own. Leszek also had a need for the same wheel, but actually, so let's stop and, you know,
I just answer. So it could happen because our engine right now is open to everyone. It's called Developer Tools for Dying Light right now. Everybody who bought Dying Light is able to create his own maps using the same tools that our designers and programmers had to create. Yes, but as I said, this could happen because some parts of the engine maybe will be someday exposed to the people, so they could compile the DLLs and launch it inside our engine. It's not a problem, I think.
Yeah, let me just quickly comment a few things. Why it's not open source? Because it's arm race. Because he wrote his own wheel, it's his competitive advantage to push twice as many polygons, which is at this point important. And no, sorry, I don't agree. It will ever be important. Nintendo tries to prove it from time to time. They succeed that the important thing is emotions, is gameplay. They managed to do it with Wii, and if you have a really good idea for gameplay, for making people feel novelty, feel great while playing, then the megahertz race is no longer important. You can just duct tape two GameCubes together.
Okay, yeah, I completely agree that it is about gameplay. And I forgot my other point.
About
open source. So I don't think it's about sharing source. I think it's about sharing ideas. I think the source code is often really hard to share because it depends on a lot of other things, and it's really hard to make them separate enough so that you can actually release them. Also, it takes a lot of time to make it separate enough, so that's usually just there is no bandwidth, no extra time to do that sort of stuff. So that's why I think it's more important to actually write about the idea and how you solve the particular problem, because typing in the code is not usually the biggest issue. It's getting the idea in the first place.
I don't know. I find many times I'm trying to find very, very precise information about, you know, I read like, I don't know, say Lucas went ahead and wrote this amazing glass thing, and he tells me about it, how the glass was full of water and it's no leakage and great. And he tells me, you know, it was kind of round and cylindrical. And I just go type my code, and it winds up that it's kind of square and it's not the way he described it. Because I don't have code to look at, I'm like, give me the code. I can read code and see where he actually verified that what he's saying is actually true. Because you know how many game dev blogs I wrote that are full of lies? You know, so I think if you're not putting your kind of, I think when you're showing code, even if it's not, it's saying, listen, this is the bit of code that is relevant, that's what I want. I'm tired of reading just airy fairy fluffy stuff. I want the code. And I'm sure if you're learning to code, also it's really handy to go see and I can find errors. It's like, Lucas, your glass kind of leaked. You know, you're like, oh no! you're just an example. Sorry, your class is okay. So I don't know. That's my.
Anyone else? Yes.
Thanks. Because there was already asked question. If you look that, if you think that 5 years from now, C++ will still be popular, and it seems that every one of you thinks so. I agree, I also do. But do you think that C-sharp will be also popular 5 years from now? Because right now I'm not sure if it is final product or it is evolving very fast, and like functional languages appearing, and there are really, really necessary because of concurrence.
That's your thing, functional programming.
Yeah. So C-sharp is actually quite the you can do functional programming in pretty much any language. You can read about it from like Carmack writing C++ in a functional way. So that's kind of cool. But you can make it with a lot of pain. It's like the equivalent of hitting yourself. But anyway, we'll deal with it kind of separately. But your question was, do you think C-sharp will be popular? Okay. So C-sharp is a language with a lot of history, probably about 20 years, my memory is hazy, but say 20 years of history of being alive and kicking, particularly in games, what, 16?
15.
Okay. So the language won't be going around anywhere. And the features that the language added in the last 5 years are kind of, you know, decreasing in importance, I think. Like, from 5 to 6, there was basically a few operators. So, but what I mean by that is that the core of the language won't move much, I think. Roslyn is cool, whatever. So you can keep on that virtual machine. And I think that's where the importance is. If you learn C-sharp or F-sharp or Vue, which is a really nice Python-like language, you'll still be on the .NET core on Mono, and I think you'll be safe. So if you want to bet on them, I think it's cool.
Okay, you stole my point. So, yeah, I just wanted to say that C-sharp as a C-sharp does not have anything super special to offer. It could be, I don't know, Java or something. The strength behind C-sharp is that it has .NET, and it was made as Mono, which is very cool for cross-platform porting. I'm a fan of Unity, obviously, so they did a great job for cross-platform. You're saving a lot of time, money, development effort, whatever. If you want to bring your game into as many platforms as possible, we've evaluated C++ engine for this, that was Marmalade, and we quickly gave up looking how differently the cross-platform thing looks with Unity, how well they have done it. But again, going back to C++, right now Unity does their own virtual machine implementation with compiling C-sharp back to C++ instead of going for Mono. So as a tool to use some kind of a virtual machine, right now Mono or .NET being the thing of choice, C-sharp is safe. If someone came with a next generation like .NET was to Java virtual machine, then he may came up with a language, with a next generation of language that will cut the history and implement only the modern stuff. This is how I see it right now.
One more thing. Also, C-sharp is quite a nice language. Loads of libraries. XNA, if you're trying to learn games, Unity is its own thing and it's great that it's there and you can do multi-platform. But if you're trying to learn, I found XNA was a beautiful a kind of learning tool that sadly went away. But Mono game is still there, so, you know, I don't know. I think it's a recommendable little SDK.
Okay, question.
Question.
Maybe not a question, but just a quick thought still about inventing the wheel again and open source. Because I think nowadays we have to kind of watch out for open sources in C++ because many times I needed something that was already written, so I didn't want to write it again. So I went to the GitHub, find something, it looks pretty nice, put it into code. And then very strange things start to happen. This isn't working, this isn't optimal, there is a function with to-do comment inside. So this is about that. So from time to time, it's good to write something on your own.
But it's. I'll just say that this also happens in commercial software. So.
Yeah, it reminds me one thing about C++ and open source and stuff. The problem with C++ is that there's no standardized conventions, like I don't know naming, like as with C#. But the problem is like if you take some code from somewhere, it probably won't fit into your code base, and you will want to rewrite it in a way. That's the problem I found with C++. Like it's not that common in other languages because you usually have some like predefined. Yeah, coding standards. Yeah, that's the thing. And there's, I think this is one of the drawbacks of C++ right now.
One of the things, like, first, yes, what you described happened in commercial software too, but the fact that it's open source gives you the chance to go in and fixing it. And whatever you put in your code is really your responsibility. So, you know, it's like...
No, just show that. Every time, I don't know what you are putting in your code, but but yes, but most of the time this is some kernel things, for example, a lock-free queue or something like that, and these small things, these building blocks, usually fit. I don't know anybody that is trying to implement texture manager from GitHub. It's something really strange. That's only small things, and that should fit. Yeah.
I just wanted to say that besides C#, I'm a great fan of open source, and of course, there's the Latin saying that the one who enters should beware. And I've seen things like iterating on milliseconds in for loop to slow down the code in open source solutions. So you need to know that these things happen. But usually there's some kind of way to measure how popular is certain solution, so you can be safe or not. I don't remember the name, but there was an open source STL implementation made by a Russian guy, and it was a de facto standard in game development at least a few years ago. We've actually saved one of our projects when moving from custom port of Box2D to a pre-released open source port for Nintendo DS when one guy went and did all the work of porting floating point into a fixed point emulation, and it saved us a few months of work and the whole project deadline, and we could actually concentrate on making the gameplay. So if you know that you need to beware of certain stuff, open source, I would say, is a great way to go. And as you said, this is a way to verify others' code. This evolves very well.
You mentioned the STL. I wasn't said this before. We are not using the STL. We've got our own STL. It's called TTL. And yes. And why we re-implemented this? Because we need, for example, a memory tracking. We need to track memory leaks, and containers with our allocators works best for us. And that's no obvious way to do it with standard template library. Yes. Another example is RTTI, the runtime type information. Is on our side. We are not using this, and we are not using exceptions, for example. We are compiling our code without RTTI support and without the exceptions.
I think there was one more question. Yeah.
Okay, hi. Kind of talked about this. I just wanted to ask how many of you use C++ standard library? Like, I think this, from my experience, is one of great C++ weaknesses, that people are very distrustful towards it. They don't really want to use it for various reasons. And that doesn't happen in other languages. Like, how many of you writing in C# uses custom containers? Yeah, like custom list, for instance. Like list.
Oh,
No. Yeah, but yeah. Yeah, but in C++, wherever I worked, each company had its own implementation of vector, for instance. Yeah, and yeah, but isn't that like one of the greatest C++ weaknesses? That it's kind of...
Why should you do
it? Why should we? Yeah.
Compiler didn't support the templates, and you just couldn't use STL, so we had to roll our own. And I think our own versions are still more optimal than the STL is, for the simple reason, for example, that we don't call copy constructors when moving elements. I don't know why you would want to do that in very very specific situations, but we have a long history. And that's why we did it.
Just about these copy constructors, now with C++ 11, you've got these moving constructors, so it's no longer relevant, I think, like, really. Yeah.
Okay, so just final words.
Yeah, and it's going to be about C#. So I wanted to say that you pointed out one of the biggest strengths of C#, that it has a very good standard library. And this is one of the reasons why it's growing more and more popular. And people can actually solve their problems without going into what you self solving the problems of the library of the software itself. And I would be happy to see something like this trustful and more universal libraries, maybe more object-oriented as well in next C++.
Okay, let's not go into the dark, dark side. Yeah. Okay. Unfortunately, as you can see, the subject we can go on and on about it for hours, but sadly we have to go. So that's a wrap. And thank you everyone for attending. Thank you to the participants of the panel. Thanks.